Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Will and Desire Principles question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentations, Human Will Principles and Human Desire Principles. Recorded on the 25th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Sorry for being late, but as you can imagine, there's a lot of questions to read. I think there's about 70 or so. So I'm not going to get to answer those. I've marked 23 of them, but I don't think I will get to answer 23 of them either. We'll see how we go. All right, so this session that we're now in is Human Will and Desire Principles Q&A. So we're now merging the two principles together. And the main reason why we're merging them together is because desire and will are both a part of your will. They are both part of your will. But we're separating them because there's a whole set of principles that only act on desire, and there's a whole set of principles that only act on will. So when I say only act on will, the law either engages the will or engages the desire. And the desire function in the human soul is a higher in hierarchy than the will-based functions in the human soul. So we've separated them for those reasons. Now, let's get started on the questions. Karen, Henry, where are you? Down here. If we can have your question 3 and 4, Karen. And just let me get my next one. Patricia, where are you? Can we have the other mic over this side? And Patricia, if you just keep your hand up. Thanks for Richard. Thank you. So you'll be next after Karen. Thank you, Karen.
So can God gift us faith that then increases our desire? If yes, what determines the reception of the gift of faith? Is it desire?
Well, the question sort of indicates a misunderstanding. Remember that desire is your current faith. Mm-hmm. And the answer to the question, can God gift you faith? No, he can't. Can I explain why?
Yes.
The reason why is that faith is the thing that's on the part of the human. The human must develop it. And if you examine the pageant messages, it says that quite clearly, actually. The message from Solomon, if you think about it. It says that what is the greatest thing from God's perspective? The love. What's the greatest thing from the human's perspective? Faith. And so faith is actually the greatest desire, or faith is the greatest thing that you can exercise in anything. And so and the reason why, of course, is because it's the thing that causes you to change and transform. So your next question then comes into play. So I'd like to answer your next question.
Does the reception of God's love always enable new desires because you're now more in harmony with God's principles and therefore your will has changed? And is that why the reception of God's love is the most rapid way of change?
Yes. So now we get to see the operation of the love. If we receive God's love, it enables greater faith, but it doesn't guarantee greater faith, because faith still has to exist within the soul, come from the soul. If you say faith is your current desire is your current level of faith, can you see that it has to come from within your soul and be exercised? So but when you receive God's love, you enter a new expanded condition. This new expanded condition allows you to see new potentials. Once you see new potentials, there's a higher likelihood that you're going to have faith about those new potentials. Desires, in other words, develop within you about those new potentials that you didn't have before. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
So the reception of God's love obviously does affect your faith. And in fact, it affects your faith to the greatest degree, because God's love being the highest quality of God that you can accept, and coming into the soul, and the faith is the highest quality you can develop from within yourself. Now we have your highest quality pulling in God's highest quality, transforming you to a new condition. This new condition makes you aware of new things. Once you're aware of new things, you start asking
why
about those things, which then causes new faith to develop on new things. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It also causes another issue thing, and that is your faith now turns on the things that you had faith in before, now turns into reality. So do you know what I mean by that? So your faith, your desire gets transformed into reality. It now, you could say it now gets transformed from desire into what is your current state.
Yeah.
So what happens there is, let's say for example, and just give you a few basic examples there, even without involving God's love. Let's say you desire to know about how you could transform matter, right? And once you learnt how to do it, so the desire is faith. You have faith that it's possible. Then you'd have to learn how to do it. Now, that's going to be driven by your desire. You won't learn unless you have a desire. But once you have a desire and you start learning, you might actually finish up doing it. Once you do it, your faith is no longer required on that issue, is it?
It's an experience.
Because now it's a permanent experience that's a part of your nature and you know how to do it. You don't have to have faith in some future condition.
It's part of the world.
It's now part of your actual state. That makes sense to you?
Yeah, it does. Thank you very much.
Yeah, good question. So, could we go to Patricia? This is your question. If we can start with your question 3, Patricia.
Is faith just the confidence that we can accomplish what we desire?
Yes, it is. It's not just a confidence, though, is it? It's like it's more than confidence, because it's a feeling that it's reality before it's reality. Does that make sense to you? So that's just not confidence, because confidence can be easily swayed, you know. An attack here and a bit of a push around there, and before you know it, your confidence is dented, right? Faith doesn't get dented like that, right? Faith is something that you hold on to no matter what. So I would call it more than confidence, but it's a good way of thinking about it, because it's about, as you've stated in your question, it's about the idea that you can accomplish the things you desire. You know, you can accomplish something. And I see many of you still using the word faith and desire separately, but really faith is the true desire. Does that make sense? That's what faith really is. It is true desire. It's the future aspired to condition, right? That's what faith is. So if you examine the definitions, there we said it's the genuine expression of current soul-based faith, and we've said that is expressed as an intended or aspired to soul-based emotional state. And it's not just an emotional state, obviously. It's more than that, because the emotional state drives all things. It's an aspired to state, which obviously is going to be driven by emotions. You know, in fact, if there are no emotions involved, there's no such thing as an aspired to state. So every scientist on the planet has an aspired to state of investigation. Otherwise, they wouldn't bother spending their whole life trying to find out something. So at the moment, we've got probably hundreds of thousands of scientists all searching for the cure for cancer. A lot of their motivations are not in harmony with some of God's principles, unfortunately, because they want to patent. They're working for institutions that would patent the actual discovery. So in that regard, they're out of harmony with God's pure, what God would measure as pure desire. But they still have a large amount of desire that is quite pure, because they are spending all of their life doing it. Like years and years and years of their life go by, 10 years, 20 years of their life go by discovering one thing. You know, you've got to be pretty dedicated to knowing that you can find a solution, don't you? You've got to believe with your whole heart that you can find the solution before you will spend all of your life doing something. Yeah. Okay, so my next question I wanted to go to was, it's a bit hard to keep track of all these questions. So Pierre, where are you? Down the front here. So if we have Richard's mic over with you. Keep your hand up, Pierre, so Richard knows where you are. And Rani, where are you? You're on that side too, so it's going to be both mics over there. Thanks, Pierre. Let's start with you. Your question number one.
Is our level of self-responsibility measured by our current will? Unless we have a higher desire, more in harmony with God's laws, which higher it, or desire less in harmony with God's laws, which lower it.
Okay, so your main part of this question firstly starts with a probably a misunderstanding on your part, Pierre. You were basically asking, when I am self-responsible, is it measured by my current will unless I have a desire? Is basically the first part of the question. Well, self-responsibility is defined, as we've defined it, as a desire. So actually, when you're in this state where there are no desires, which actually, when you think about it, is quite impossible to achieve, really, for most people. You usually have some desires about something, right? But imagine for a moment there were no desires about anything, then you would have zero self-responsibility. Doesn't matter whether you're a six-sphere spirit or anything, you'd have zero responsibility if that state was possible, which obviously it's not, but you would have zero self-responsibility. So self-responsibility is the desire for self-awareness, the desire for truth, the desire for love, the desire to live in harmony with the principles, the desire to discover one's nature, and so forth, is it not? So where does self-responsibility enter? Here, can you see? What God's trying to train us with regard to self-responsibility, he's trying to tell us that everything is driven by desire. And the reason why he's trying to tell us that is for this reason. If you're reluctantly forced into things, which is this area here, obviously you're going to be resistive to the process every single time, aren't you? Right? But if you have a desire to engage a process, you're not going to be resistive anymore. And in fact, desire creates an interesting state in the soul that will is never able to accomplish, right, by itself. Desire actually creates an opening in the soul to reception. So if you do not have desire, it is impossible for you to receive. The actual ability for the soul to receive, technically and mathematically, is created by the soul's desire. So if you're in a state where you're resisting all the time, your will is being forced into change only because of that pressure cooker thing we talked about in the will discussion. If that's what's happening, the reality is that the desire part of your soul has not opened, and the problem with that is that you're not going to be able to receive anything, actually. You cannot receive anything that you do not have desire to receive. Now, that God's created the soul that way, and it's very important to understand that. Right? And I feel, even in this discussion of what I'm saying to you, most of you still don't really get that it's actually a function of your soul that desire opens up a certain area of your soul that is otherwise closed with regard to what it is you desire. And in fact, if you try to get things with willpower, once you achieve them, you will not be able to receive them anyway, unless desire is present. You see what I'm saying? So you won't actually receive anything, even if you think you're striving for it using willpower. You won't actually receive it as a gift. You won't. You won't view it as a gift. You'll believe it's an attainment, something you deserved, which means that you're not now open to the concept of a gift being given. And pretty much everything that brings us the most pleasure is gifts rather than attainments. You know, does that make sense? So while attainments are obviously good, we can achieve certain things, at the end of the day, the real pleasure comes from the soul by receiving a gift and actually actuating that gift in your life, you know. And that particularly applies to the reception of God's love. So if you try to willpower yourself to receive God's love, which many of you have done, impossible to do, because God's love doesn't respond to will, it responds to desire, right? So God's love won't even respond to your current condition, no matter how good your current condition is. So you can be already at one with God and want to get to the stage where you don't want to receive more love. And by the way, as I've mentioned, that's also an impossibility, because by that stage you really do want to. But if that could be achieved theoretically, then you would receive no more love, right? Because it's desire that continues that receptive process. Desire, as I say, opens up a function, a part of your soul, that allows energies to flow from potential sources that they couldn't flow from before, external to the soul. So it's desire. So when you desire knowledge, now knowledge can flow. So a person who's like trying to discover the cause of cure of cancer in a physical way will eventually find, because of this principle, the physical cure for cancer, even though emotions might continue to cause cancer and create cancer. You follow me? But they may find the physical solution to cancer in terms of the scientific process, because there are scientific processes involved with everything. They may find that. But at the end of the day, if they don't desire to see that the cause of it is emotional, then they will keep treating cancer, even though they have the solution to it, but cancer will keep occurring. Does that make sense? In other words, they haven't solved the real problem yet, because to solve a real problem, you've got to treat the cause of the problem. But without desire, they couldn't even find the physical solution. Does that make sense? They wouldn't. They wouldn't even be working on it without desire. So when you desire knowledge, knowledge will flow. When you desire information, information will flow. When you desire other things, truly desire them properly in a pure way, if you desire money, money will flow. That's the way it is. But not in a impure, it's not impure desire. As soon as it's impure, it's like, I want more money than you. Now it's impure. Or I want my money to feed my addictions. Now that's impure. You see what I'm saying? Pure desire will always make the thing that you're desiring flow in and out of your life. Because remember, all things that flow have to have an entry point and an exit point. Otherwise, it becomes like a dam that gets more full and more full, and eventually nothing can flow. Does that make sense? For things to flow, there has to be a source higher and an exit lower for things to flow. And that applies to your emotions and your knowledge and every other thing as well. So in other words, if you decided to want knowledge, but only because you wanted it and you weren't going to share it, you're not going to receive much knowledge, because it's not flowing out of you. You see? Basic principle of life. Desire is the thing that engages it. Yeah. Peter, you'd like to ask? Sorry, Rani. Can I go to Rani first? Is that all right? If we can go to Rani first. Because I've got a list of important things I want to answer first, and then we'll go to the...
Which one?
Question number one, Rani.
One? Okay.
Thank you.
If will and desire are in harmony, change is not possible. How does this relate to when they are both in harmony with love and truth?
So let's say your will is in harmony with love and truth, and your desire is in harmony with love and truth. Okay, what does it look like then? Well, to be in harmony with love and truth, desire would have to always be present, would it not? Which exceeds your current condition, if it's in harmony with love and truth. Can you see? Like if desire wasn't present anymore, then you're no longer in harmony with love and truth. Isn't that the case?
Yep.
So desire will always exceed will, in fact. So what God's trying to teach us there is that he wants us to get into the state where we recognize desire is the thing that causes us to continue our development. Will is the state that we currently have attained in development. Desire is the state that of what we future aspire to, what we want to be, how we want to be. So to be in harmony with love and truth and in harmony with the development principle, desire would always have to be present. So you cannot even reach at one with God without desire always being present. Do you follow?
Yeah.
So the state of one, those two being equal, never actually occurs. That's what God's trying to teach you. Because if it did occur, what would happen?
You'd stagnate.
Stagnate. Are you now progressing towards the infinite?
No.
No. Can you see? God wanted your natural state so that your will and desire are always different. That's what God's trying to teach you.
Cool.
Make sense?
Yeah. Thank you.
Kerry, where are you? Kerry? Yes, if we can go to you next. Straight behind. And who's after Kerry? Is Max? Where are you, Max? On this side? Thank you. You're number two, Max, on yours. Kerry, your question is number one. Thanks.
Can you please explain what new potentialities of compensation, responsibility, governance, redemption, and transformation principles enabled by human desire means?
Yes, so basically you remember our four or five really primary principles that use for building blocks of order. We had the scope, remember that? Right? It was the first part that we needed to build order. And then we had hierarchy, governance, responsibility and compensation. They were all needed to build order, weren't they?
Yes.
Now what we're suggesting is all of those foundation and order-based principles would have no further potentiality without desire. So what we're saying is the principles we're going to discuss with you tomorrow, transformation, redemption and transformation, redemption, the human side of redemption, would occur without desire, but the other side of redemption, divine redemption and transformation, could never occur without desire. So you could say that desire is the key for which the highest possible principles are engaged. And without desire, you would just be left with compensation, hierarchy, governance, self-responsibility as being the way that you live your life.
Yep.
The problem with that is it offers no further potentiality. Desire is the thing that offers potentiality to the soul. Without desire, there'd be no additional potentiality other than the potentialities received through the engagement of those order-based principles. Yeah. Does that make sense to you, Kerry?
Yeah, thank you.
So what that means then is that without desire, transformation is not possible. And without desire, divine redemption is not possible. We'll talk about those tomorrow. Mm. Desire is the key to your future existence.
Yeah.
Thank you. Otherwise, what all that would happen is all of us would just return back to the perfect natural man, the perfect natural human condition that God created in the first place.
Yep.
Right. And no, we'd have no other potentiality of expansion beyond that point.
Yeah. So is it like, could you say that desire almost pulls you through your current will state? Like it...
Not almost, it does.
It does, yeah.
Without desire, you will remain as you are.
Yeah.
And the only thing that's going to cause that change is pressure cooker. The pressure cooker of God's laws, of the lower laws, the order-based laws. Does that make sense? Which are all to do with the law of attraction bringing you pain and then you getting so much pain that eventually you release it.
Yeah.
Right? Desire allows you to go beyond pain as a motivator. Does it not?
Yes.
And now it's driven by a future aspired to condition. Now it becomes your motivator. You see, and this is, remember right back at the beginning when we had AG1, Assistance Group 1 with you, we talked about the problem of pain being your motivator, which for many of you it still is the only motivator you have. And this is the problem, is that you're not exercising desire. And unfortunately in that place, pain becomes a correction of your will, becomes your only motivator. Right? And that's a problem. Yeah. For your own happiness and for your own life, you know.
Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Max, it was question two. Sorry, so just let me look at my thing here. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm sure I had a 7. But I must be mistaken. It might have been on the back of something. Just let me see. No, that's that was the main ones I wanted to cover first, and then we're off. Then we're off to the normal ones. So here we go. Next question two.
From God's perspective, is human free will predictable or predetermined?
Well, when you say human free will, it depends upon your definition, right? Remember, in the will principles, if I just go back to the will, remember we had free will, which is the gift God gave. Of course, from that God's perspective, that's predictable. It's his gift to us, so that's predictable. But if you're talking about human will itself, right, which is not human free will, it's just human will, then is the question is that predictable? Well, will is this, isn't it?
But isn't it both?
Well, if you're saying it, you merged with desires.
Yeah, I'm talking about the whole.
Yeah. Now, the question you asked, though, is from God's perspective, is human will predictable? Mm. Now, from even the most developed spirit's perspective, human will is, if you consider it as the will, merging of will and desire, it is not predictable, even to the higher spirit. And the reason why is because desire is what causes unpredictability. Mm. Will is predictable. Mm. Given the person has this thing in that situation, they're going to act a certain way, right? Without a doubt. Mm. That's predictable. That part of it is predictable. But this is not so predictable, is it? You might one moment have a desire here and then bang, you've switched your desire and it's something completely different. Now you've become unpredictable. Right, so from a spirit's analysis, you become unpredictable. But the difference for God is that God is omnipotent, which means that God can mathematically calculate not only all of your will-based emotional conditions, but he can also calculate the potentials of all of your desire-based emotional conditions. So he's different than a human soul is in that regard. So from God's perspective, you're still predictable. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yep. But from everybody else's perspective in the universe, as soon as you engage desire, you become unpredictable. Isn't that great? It's like, oh, that's unpredictable. Oh, look at what they did there. Isn't it fantastic? But imagine what life would be like if you could predict everything going on around you. It's like, ho-hum, ho-hum. Everything would be just another one of there. I knew that was going to happen. Now, the reality is, though, when your development increases, you are able to predict more the way God predicts. So in other words, you can see the current condition and you can also see the desires that are going or are being exercised in the moment. And as a result of that, you can merge the two of those things and make calculations that allow you then to predict the course of events for that particular person. But it doesn't mean you're always going to be right, because desire is unpredictable. They might change it the next moment, and before you know, everything changes. And this is also why it's very, very hard to predict what would, aside from God's predictions, it's very, very hard for anybody to predict what may happen to the earth, for example, and what may happen to people on it. Because at the end of the day, you've got all these different people having all sorts of desires. Some are very negative and destructive, and some are positive and so forth. And so it becomes very difficult to predict what 25 to 27 billion people are going to do. Does that make sense? You imagine the amount of calculations you need based on every single emotional belief and thought that the person may have, measuring that energy, calculating it all mathematically before you come up with the solution. Huge amounts of calculations that would be necessary to actually fully be able to predict. So the reality is we humans can only predict the future if we receive actual communication from God about that future, because it's only God who actually knows what the future holds. Make sense? Yeah. Interesting question, though. Hunter, where are you? Up the back there. And Dave Roseman, where are you? There. So we can have one mic with Dave, one with Hunter. Thank you.
So when we're engaging what we think are our desires, but we don't always feel I mean, sometimes we feel good, sometimes we don't feel bad. Is it that it's not our true desire, or is that we're not being sincere?
Yeah, so the question as you wrote it here was, if we act on a, if we act, I don't know that word. So if we act thinking we're acting on a desire, but we don't feel great doing what we think we desire, is it because they aren't our true desires? Well, obviously, yes, they're not our true desires. The reality is, if you're acting on true desires, they will always feel great when you start achieving them. Does that make sense? So even if you get to a stage where you don't actually achieve what you were hoping to achieve, acting on the desire, which is acting in faith, is always going to bring very positive feelings to you, always, right? So if you're not feeling great doing it, then obviously there's got to be some other thing going on, doesn't there? Now, it could be that you just need to purify the desire. So it doesn't necessarily mean that the desire is faulty, does it? It could just mean that you've got a fair bit of your will mixed in with it, where you've got some addictions mixed in and so forth, and you just need to get rid of those. And this is what I see many doing, is they act upon a desire that actually is quite sincere at the beginning, but addictions, you know what they're like, you know, they just go, you start going, oh. So you act on a desire. So what? Let's say the desire might be to create a business. The business becomes successful. Now that kicks in some other addictions of, wow, I really like this success. I'm really enjoying this success. I can use this success to get some of my other addictions met, like sexual addictions and so forth. Wow, you know, like this sounds good to me. But now your desire is no longer pure, and you're going to get some negative consequences as a result of that. And this happens frequently on earth, right, doesn't it? Where a person engages a pure desire only to end up in an impure state. Many musicians end up like this in their life. They engage a desire, which is to write music. They write music, they play it. All of a sudden some people like it. This connects with other addictions. And before they know it, they're so engaged in the other addictions that their music suffers, of course, as does most of their other parts of their life suffer. Now, that's an example of, yeah, we just need to purify the desire and keep it pure. Right, and our desires not remaining pure are often influenced by our will-based condition and having no aspiration to go away from the will-based condition. So for example, you have a desire for music. Now the desire is going to lead you to be successful if it's a sincere desire with regard to music. But the problem with that is if you don't deal with the desire to have addictions met, of sexual addictions met, then the music's going to bring you an exposure of your sexual addictions, and you start engaging that, before you know it, you're degrading in your condition. Does that make sense? So sometimes this is what we observe happening, where desire is engaged, it's pure at the beginning, but unfortunately because of our other addictions, it severely degrades over time. Yeah. So this is where we need to be very careful. We need to make sure we still desire to deal with the other things in our life that would cause the degradation. Good question, though. David?
Was it the first or second?
Second question, thanks, mate. Yep.
Can the intensity of our desire grow as we engage it and refine our use of it?
Yes, that's the interesting thing about desire, is you start engaging it, you get some feedback, and if it's pure, you'll definitely get some good feedback, you'll have some nice feelings as a result of it. This is going to increase your desire to do it some more. Does that make sense? And God's created it like that, and particularly that's how God's created it, with receiving God's love. You receive a little bit at the beginning, not much of a desire, but you have some sincere desire, you receive a little bit, and then receiving it has changed things in your life, and you start going, whoa, I think I need to do that more, right? And that's the beauty of a growing, intensive desire, starting out quite small, but again, eventually being quite large. Okay, thanks, Nate.
Thanks.
Could we, I've gone there with Patricia, so that's all right. Can you please describe? Yes, Glani, where are you? Thank you. Can we have you next? And Just let me see where I'm at. Who's that behind? That's Nikki. Can we have Nikki next? You're down there. So Lani, then Nikki.
I'm all mixed up with my questions.
All right. You asked, could you please describe the process of purifying desire?
Mm. Right? Yes, please.
And how it can change the will. Now, it naturally follows on from David's question, doesn't it? Sort of, how can I go about purifying this desire? Well, an impure desire is really not going to be responded to by the law, is it? Well, when you say an impure desire, it depends what kind of desire it is, doesn't it? If it's a sincere, impure desire, then that's going to cause degradation. If it's a sincere, pure desire, that's going to cause positive growth, is it not? Right? But if it's an insincere, impure desire, that's going to get you nothing. If it's an insincere, pure desire, that's going to get you nothing either. Does that make sense? Aside from God's laws demonstrating your insincerity, that's all it's going to get. So this is the funny thing about desires we see a lot. People have an insincere, pure desire, and then they expect to get a result. Well, of course, there are no results from an insincere, pure desire. There's no such thing. It's just an imaginary state. So how do I measure whether I have a sincere desire or an insincere one? This is a real question, isn't it? Well, you don't have to measure it because the desire principle measures it for you, right? So the desire principle, which we'll go to, this desire principle says it measures it. It says it responds to the desire. So the desire principle measures your desire. And if it's sincere, can you see the in harmony with love? The definition is in harmony with love and truth, if it's sincere. What does compensation say? Compensation rewards desires in harmony with love and truth, doesn't it? So therefore, if it's sincere, you'll feel the rewards. If it's insincere, what will you feel?
You'll feel the penalty.
The penalties. Does that make sense? So a person who degrades in their condition over time will look back and they go, either I did not have I must have a desire to degrade. Because if they didn't have a desire to degrade, they would stay the same. Mm-hmm. And if they have a desire to grow, they would grow. So if they stayed the same, so many of you have stayed the same as I've known you 8 years ago. So that tells me that what you think is a sincere desire, God doesn't think is one. And what you think is, you know, degradation, God doesn't think that is either. Because otherwise you would not be in the same state as you currently are, right? So many of you have believed up till now that degradation is when you do something and out of an unloving desire and you degrade. Well, that part of it's true. But many of you think that if you willpower yourself to do something good, that's not degradation. Well, that part's false. That's degradation. Right? So this is a problem, right? How we measure things is not based on attitude, not based on intention, but based on what the outcome is most of the time. That's how we're measuring. And God's not interested in the outcome hardly. He knows that a desire that's intentionally in harmony with love and truth will always create good outcomes. His laws guarantee it. So he knows that. So he doesn't worry about the outcome. He knows that every outcome will be good if you engage desires in harmony with love. He knows that. He's more concerned about your desire engaged in harmony with love than he is in anything else. Hence, the responsibility principle. That whole principle wouldn't exist if God had decided, you know, your desire doesn't matter and the outcomes do. Just get it done. And can you see many of you have that concept in your life? Just get this done. Just get this done. Just get this done. Just get this done. That's not the way God would like it to be. God wants it to be, what is your intentions in getting it done. It's not the outcome that matters to God, it's your desire to live in harmony with love and truth that matters to him. He knows that will produce good outcomes in the long run. So, you know, on earth it's difficult sometimes to measure. In the first century, I had lots of what you guys would probably call arguments with my father, for example. But eventually he came around through God's way, you know. Most of my brothers and sisters ignored divine truth for a lot of their lives and then a fair bit of their spirit life. But they come around sooner or later. So a person who understands the power of love and truth is not impatient. We're patient. We know the outcome is always going to be good in the long run. In the long run. Ooh, I want to tell you. That's the thing. You'll find out in the long run that it works, right? Yeah. Okay, now Nikki is next.
What question number?
Three, thanks, Nikki.
Okay. Do our guides first try to inspire us and then slowly back off to help us see the importance of our desire in determining our future?
Yes, they do. Very simple, isn't it? You can see why. Because if we're reliant on inspiration in our life, we're out of harmony with the desire principle. So our guides, firstly, they try to inspire us to get a desire. But once we start getting one, they just start stepping back, let him manage his own life now. And that's why sometimes it goes like, well, it was so easy before, now it's a bit harder. And the reason why is because you got less personal, you got less external help to help you there. And instead, you've got to develop it through your own aspiration. Now, spirits of a lower condition who are on the natural love path, they don't do that. They will continue helping you, continue making your life nice and pleasant and whatever else, continue organizing things around you. And so many people on earth who have been driven by spirits arrive in the hells of the spirit world as a result because they are yet to develop a single desire. Their only desire is to be driven by inspiration, and they get inspired, often to do unloving things, but even if it's to do loving things. So many of them do loving things on earth, only to find they're still in the hells when they pass. Because it wasn't their desire to do it. Their current condition was much worse. They were giving away their will, giving away their self-expression, not discovering their own nature, not being self-responsible in their life. Can you see where they're going to end up? And this is a big shock to many. Can you imagine? It's a big shock to many. And in fact, many people who we know who have passed in the last 8 years have had a huge shock after they passed. They thought they knew divine truth, so that means that everything would be fine, but there hasn't been a desire on their part. It's just been inspiration. Huge shock, yeah. Many mediums on this planet arrive in the spirit world in that condition because it's a huge shock to them. They believe they know all these things, and then when they pass, they realize, maybe they didn't know the essential things of life, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, but oftentimes they pass in a terrible place because there's this instant of confusion, and then afterwards, there's usually a lot of rage, which then causes them to act more unlovingly and even further degrade their condition. They're in a rage because they have arrived somewhere where they didn't think they deserved. Mm-hmm. Yeah, many religious people on earth, Muslim and Christian, finish up in those same conditions. Desire, very, very important part of life. Okay, it's amazing how fast 50 minutes goes. So I've got 5 minutes and that's it. Okay. Did I answer you, Max? No, that was, I've pretty much answered that question. Yes. I'm now being selective. Rebecca, too, your second question. Rebecca, and it might be the last question that I get to answer, unfortunately. I might answer one more, but of a person who's not here. Question number two.
If God wants us to be emotional beings, with capacity for happiness. Did God not create us happy in the beginning, or did God only create the capacity?
Yeah, good question. Many people have this belief that God created us like with happiness inbuilt inside of us and with a lot of other things inbuilt inside of us. That's not the case at all. God basically created us with personality and attributes and properties, internal properties. Remember, we went through that with scope. He created us with internal properties. But he didn't create us with, he didn't inject all of these things into our soul that we didn't already then have. So we have to create them ourselves, right? We have to learn about how to create them ourselves. Mm-hmm. So with regard to happiness, we were a blank slate. We were neither unhappy or happy. Does that make sense? And this is the case with love as well. With, as regards love, we were in a blank slate. We were neither loving or unloving. You follow? And this is what we must consider. Because we're created in a state where we were sort of a blank slate, we were neither loving nor unloving, neither happy nor unhappy, then this gives us the perspective, the potential of learning about love and learning about what a lack of love does and learning about happiness and learning the opposite of happiness, pain and suffering and those things. It helps, gives us this potential. Do you follow? Now, if God didn't do it this way, then really God would have overcome our gift of will, free will. See, it's our free will, the gift of free will, that allows us to discover these things. And so God, because he gave us the gift of free will, decided to create a lot of these things that we can generate through life experience in a, what you would call a, what would you call it, a static, there's a word for it, no, it just doesn't come to me at the moment. No, it's sort of like a state that's neutral. You're neutral. It's a neutral state with regard to most things. So we're neither happy nor unhappy, loving nor unloving. That's the soul at its point of incarnation. But now the life experience determines what happiness will become and what love is and how we'll experience our life determines a lot of the emotions we'll eventually feel. And that's not only us either, because everything is interconnected. Through the scope and the hierarchy principles, everything is interconnected. We can see that your happiness is very important to me. Do you follow? If I'm in a state of love, your happiness will be very important to me, not just my happiness important to me, because I understand interconnectivity. Does that make sense? And I understand what happens when people become unhappy and how that affects my life and their life. So God wanted this experiential process to occur so that we could understand the power of our desire and the importance of actually self-responsibility, developing a desire to have experiences that actually teach me about love and teach me about truth and so forth, which are driven through the exercise of my will.
Are you neutral to your soulmate then in incarnation?
Yes. Mm. Mm. That's why most of you haven't discovered them, right? You're neutral in most things. Right? There is an attraction, though. There's a natural attraction that's potentially there. It's just a matter of whether you engaged it or not. But you have to engage it. Anything that's developed by desire, desire must first be engaged for its development to occur. And the soulmate relationship is developed by desire in one of the most pure ways, right? So therefore, it has to be engaged in order to occur. Makes sense, right? Yeah. It's a clever little system. Okay. I do have maybe a question for one more. So it's got to be something that's... Monique, five. Question five for you, thanks. You don't have to stand. You're in the third row.
Is it the could dreaming? Is
that that's tough? The one, yeah, that's the one.
Okay. Could dreaming up or imagining what I'd like to be or in relationships to be like be a way of igniting desire?
Yeah, interesting question, eh? So you get your daydream. Just go daydream. And yes, can you see that would work? No? If you just daydream about yourself being this magnificently loving person. Just wanting to bring pleasure to every person you meet. and you think about that and you wonder about that, that certainly might actually trigger some desire to do it, wouldn't it?
Sorry, I'm not sure. Like, I'm
why
not
aren't you sure?
Well, doing the homework,
yep.
reflecting on self-responsibility,
yep.
I found myself starting to imagine myself taking different actions
yep.
and who I could become. And yep. I have never thought about myself becoming that type of person before.
Yep.
But then I feel when I actually desire to change on something, it's a different feeling inside
well, that's,
of me.
That's when the wheel's kicking in, your current condition starts kicking in. So the beauty of imagining things, which certainly does help you develop desire, is that sometimes your imagination will turn into faith, and then faith is a desire. But it's not always guaranteed, isn't it? You can sometimes imagine things and it's just a hope. Well, that's not faith, that's not desire. Hoping things is not desire. You follow me? And therefore not faith. Hoping things is just, like, usually what hope is driven by is this feeling of, I want it to be that way. Please let it be that way. Please, please. You know, like a pleading type of thing. But it's not a belief that it can be that way. You follow? So you've got to be careful. Imagination can actually create hope, which is pretty much pointless for the operation, or imagination can create faith, which will be the seed of your desire. It just depends on how you nurture it and what you do to build it. Does that make sense? So you can imagine future-based states and finish up not having a desire to obtain them and just hoping that some magical process will occur and you obtain them. And this is what I see some of you doing too, where you're imagining what, you know, when I talk about being at one with God, you sort of imagine it and it feels pretty good. But then you only have hope that somebody else will do it for you. In other words, no self-responsibility, no desire developed within yourself to make that happen for yourself, you see? So you can say that while imagination or dreaming up things can be helpful to trigger a potential desire, it's not always guaranteed, because if you just hope for it and you want somebody else still to do it, you know, no self-responsibility, then of course it's never going to happen anyway. And then what will end up? You will end up disappointed, won't you? That the thing you hoped for is not realised. Usually hope, not realised, ends up in disappointment. Often anger and other things are triggered through that. So it's not a guarantee, but it could be helpful. Does that make sense? Yeah. All right, well, that's the end of our Q&A on this. Obviously, as you can see, there's pages and pages and pages of questions. So we're going to try to get to answer many of those questions in our studio work that myself and Mary do. Obviously, it's a very important issue. You will see it coming up again tomorrow in both the redemption and the transformation principles that we cover tomorrow. So it's a very important issue for your welfare, for your future. And my suggestion is, if you take away anything from these principles, take away desire. Understand desire and how to develop it. That's the thing to take away with you. All right, well, we'll have a break now for 10 minutes, which means come back at 3:10, and we'll get started on our last two presentations for the day, which is God's authority and the Q&A with it. Thanks, guys. Thanks. Thank you.